And if Isa alayhi salam can go up, then why can't Rasulullah go up? So if Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was alive in his grave, then what about Rasulullah in his grave? If the Prophet was already present everywhere, then what was the need for the Prophet to go from Makkah to Baitul Maqdis if he is already there? Prophet fell asleep, it shows before this event Allah had not informed his Prophet what was going to happen. All the Prophets are praying behind Rasulullah. Rasulullah is Imam, he recited Fatiha, but the previous Prophets didn't have Fatiha, so they couldn't recite Fatiha. So if all the previous Prophets, was their Salat valid behind Rasulullah or not?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونصلي ونسلم على رسوله الكريم أما بعد. My dear respected brothers and elders and sisters and honorable listeners, today the mas'ala which we like to discuss is regarding masha al jawrabain, i.e. doing masha over normal socks when a person is doing wudu and is performing ablution. Is it permissible for him to wipe his wet hands over normal socks? This is the mas'ala, an issue which inshallah ta'ala we would like to mention in some detail today. But before going into the actual discussion, I would like to mention a few things as a tamheed, as an introduction, which is that there are many types of socks. Generally, there are many types of socks. But there are three main types which I would like to mention, which are relevant to our subject today. The first are the khuffain, the leather socks. The leather socks which we see today, according to all the a'imma and the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, you are allowed to do masa over leather socks due to the overwhelming ahadith that have been narrated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is no dispute between the a'imma or the scholars of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah regarding masha al khuffain, doing masa and wiping your hands over leather socks. The second type of socks are the thakhinain, the safiqain. Thakhinain, safiqain means socks which are thick. Which are thick and they have certain conditions. In the books of jurisprudence, in the books of fiqh, the conditions have been written. For example, they are so thick that water cannot reach, water does not penetrate and enter within the socks. They stick onto the feet without tying them. And a person, he can walk a certain amount of distance inside these socks. According to Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullahi alayh, according to Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayh, and according to Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh, which is his most authentic opinion, that on these sort of socks doing masa is permissible. And according to Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayh, he says it's not jaiz, it's not permissible. These type of socks I will shed some light inshallah later in the talk. But before we go into that, I would like to divert everyone's attention towards the main subject, which is the third type of socks, which are called jawrabain raqiqain, the normal socks which we have today and which we use. Is it permissible to do masa on jawrabain raqiqain, the normal to thin socks, where water can easily enter in? A person cannot usually walk for a great distance in these socks. So this is the mas'ala which we like to discuss in some detail. According to all four a'imma, Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullahi alayh and Imam Abu Hanifa, all the four a'imma, they all say, they all unanimously agree that doing masa on jawrabain raqiqain, the two normal socks, is not permissible and is not jais. Inshallah ta'ala, evidence will be given. But there are some people, a group of people, a minority, who say doing masa on normal socks is permissible. So first, inshallah ta'ala, we will analyze their dalail, their evidence, and we will give answer to their dalail and explanation, inshallah, when our time. Those people who say doing masa on normal socks is permissible, they have two, three, or maybe four narrations, ahadith, where they derive this masala from. The first one which we would like to address is the hadith in Tirmidhi Sharif. This in front of me, I have Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi's kitab, Al-Jami'u Sahih, and this print is Darul Kutub Al-Ilmiya, Darul Kutub Al-Ilmiya. In here, Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, on page 82, chapter Babu Ma Ja'a Fil Mashi Adal Jawrabain Wa Na'alain, the chapter regarding those narrations which have come about doing masa on jawrabain, socks and shoes, na'alain. In here, Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi has mentioned a narration. وبه قال حدثنا هناد ومحمود بن غيلان قال حدثنا وكيع عن سفيان عن أبي قيس عن هزيل بن شرحبيل عن المغيرة بن شعبة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال توضأ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ومسح على الجوربين والنعلين. مغيرة بن شعبة رضي الله تعالى عنه reports that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he had made wudu, he had performed ablution, وَمَسَحَ عَلَى الْجَوْرَبَيْنِ, and then he didn't masha, he wiped his hands over the socks, وَالنَّعَلَيْنِ, and shoes. Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi mentioned about this hadith. قال أبو عيسى هذا حديث حسن صحيح, that this hadith is hasan and is sahih, i.e. it is authentic, according to Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi. Now there's a few things which I would like to mention about this hadith. Number one, that this hadith which has been reported by Mughira bin Shu'bah radiallahu ta'ala an in Tirmidhi Sharif, it has been criticized and weakened by a big group of muhaddithun. This, in Tuhfatul Ahwadi, I have this in front of me, which is a commentary on Tirmidhi Sharif, written by Allama Muhammad Abdul Rahman bin Abdul Rahim Al-Mubarak Furi, rahimahullah, commentating on this hadith, the author says that اعلم أن الترمذي حسن حديث الباب وصححه, that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi has authenticated this hadith, ولكن كثيرا من أئمة الحديث ضعفوه, but there are many muhaddithun who are more greater than Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi in the science of hadith, they have weakened this hadith. Therefore, I would like to start off with Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi. The dalil to this is that Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, in his Sahih al-Bukhari, he has mentioned the same narration of Mughira bin Shu'bah. I have this Bukhari Sharif in front of me. The first volume, page 58, chapter Babul Masih Al Khufain, the chapter of doing masa upon leather socks. In this chapter, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned the same narration, Mughira bin Shu'bah radiallahu ta'ala. But he hasn't mentioned the word jawrabain. Jawrabain means normal socks. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned in this chapter the words masaha ala al-khuffain, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he had done masa over leather socks. So this is evidence that Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, in this hadith, he has gone against the narration which Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi has narrated, the same sahabi Mughir bin Shu'bah. But the words in Bukhari Sharif are not jawrabain, socks, but rather The words are khuffain, leather socks. That's number one. Number two, Imam Tirmizi rahmatullah alayhi's hadith. It has also gone against Sahih Muslim. I have this Sahih Muslim in front of me. Darul Kutub al-Ilmiyya print. The first volume. Chapter Babul Masih al Khuffain. In this chapter, there are approximately 11 narrations. And 7 of them have been narrated from Bughira bin Shu'bah. 7 of those ahadith have been narrated from Mughira bin Shu'bah radiallahu ta'ala, who is the same Sahabi which Imam Tirmizi rahmatullah alayhi has mentioned in his Tirmizi Sharif. And in none of them are the words Jawrabain. All of them, the words Khuffain. The first one, فَتَوَضَّعَ وَمَسْعَدَ الْخُفَّيْنِ ثُمَّ مَسْعَدَ الْخُفَّيْنِ وَمَسْعَدَ الْخُفَّيْهِ. Similarly, again, وَمَسَّ عَلَى خُفَّيْهِ وَمَسَّهَ عَلَى خُفَّيْهِ. The net result is that all the narrations that we mentioned in Muslim Sharif, none of them have the word jawrabain, normal socks, but rather they all have khuffain. Again, this is evidence that Imam Tirmizi rahmatullahi alayhi, he's gone against Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi's narrations regarding the masa over socks. The third evidence that Imam Tirmizi rahmatullahi alayhi has also gone against Sunan Abi Dawood. I have this Abu Dawood Sharif in front of me. This is the first volume. In the first volume, chapter Babul Mas'ad al-Jawrabain, that doing mas over socks. In here, Imam Abu Dawood rahmatullahi alayhi mentions the hadith of Mughira bin Shu'bah radiyallahu ta'ala an. And he says, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ تَوَضَّأَ وَمَسَّ عَلَى الْجَوْرَبَيْنِ وَالنَّعَلَيْنِ. The same narration that has been mentioned on page 82 in Tirmizi Sharif, the same narration, same word, جَوْرَبَيْن. But Imam Abu Dawood commentates on this hadith and he says, قَالَ أَبُو دَاوُودَ كان عبد الرحمن بن مهدي لا يحدث بهذا الحديث. The عبد الرحمن بن مهدي, who is a very famous and a great muhaddith, he says that this hadith with the word جوربين, Imam عبد الرحمن بن مهدي will never mention with the words of جوربين. Why? لأن المعروف عن المغيرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مس على الخفين. Because what is famous from مغيرة بن شعبة that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم did مس over خفين, leather socks. So Imam Tirmizi رحمة الله عليه has gone against the narration in Bukhari Sharif. The words جوربين go against the words خفين in Bukhari. Similarly, he has gone against the words which have come inside Muslim Sharif. He has gone against the words which have come inside Abu Dawood Sharif. Further, I would like to give a few more narrations and quotes of Muhaddithun. In As-Sunan al-Kubra lil-Bayhaqi, I have this Sunan al-Kubra lil-Bayhaqi of Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullah alayh. In this, the first volume, page 283, Babu ma warada fil jawrabayn wa na'alayn, Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullah alayh commentates on this hadith which Imam Tirmizi rahmatullah alayh has mentioned in his book. And then afterwards, he quotes the aqwal and the sayings of the muhaddithun. He says that Muslim bin Hajjad, he had weakened this hadith. Then he mentions a saying of Sufyani Thawri rahimahullah, that he said regarding this hadith, that this hadith is da'if awwahin, that this hadith is very weak and feeble. He also mentions Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullah alayh criticizing this hadith. Abdurrahman bin Mahdi. Abdurrahman bin Mahdi, my dear brothers and sisters, is that muhaddith who has been mentioned in all the Sahih Sittah. Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawood, Tirmizi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, all of the six books of Ahadith which are famous and known as Sahih Sitta, he is the Sheikh and he is the Rawi in every single book. Abdul Rahman bin Mahdi has said that this hadith is Munkar. This hadith in Tirmidhi Sharif is Munkar. Munkar means, Allama Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah has mentioned that Munkar is Munkar and Shaz. Munkar and Shaz. Munkar and Shaz mean ما يخالف في الراوي من هو أرجح من. That way a Rawi, where a narrator, he goes against those narrators and those ruwat which are more authentic, which are more stronger. So this hadith is Munkar and is Shadh. Shadh means very rare. Munkar also means that something that is very rare and that goes against the norm. So this hadith is Shadh and Munkar. The reason is because Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi, he goes against the stronger narrations like of Bukhari and Muslim. Ali bin Madini rahimahullah, he says that this narration of Mughira bin Shu'bah and the word Jawrabain is going against all of the people of Ahli Medina, Ahli Kufa, Ahli Basra. وخالف الناس, he has gone against all of the people. Similarly, Yahya bin Ma'in, Imam al-Jarh wa al-Ta'dil, rahimahullah, he says, الناس كلهم يروونه على الخفين غير أبي قيس. That all the people, all the muhaddithun, they have narrated this hadith with the words of Khuffain, not Jawrabain, apart from Abu Qais, who is one of the narrators of this Tirmidhi Sharif hadith. Similarly, Imam Abu Dawood rahmatullah alayhi has also criticized this hadith. So my dear respected brothers and sisters, the net result is that this hadith, which Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned in Tirmidhi Sharif, it goes against all of the narrations that have been mentioned by Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam Abu Dawood. And big muhaddithun, the likes of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the likes of Sufyan al-Thawri, the likes of Yahya bin Ma'in, rahimahumullah, and the likes of Imam Abu Dawood, rahimahullah, have all criticized this hadith. Furthermore, Imam Zayla'i in Nasb al-Raya, and similarly in the commentary of Tirmizi Tuhfat al-Ahwadi, it has been narrated from Imam Nawawi rahmatullahi alayh that ittafaq al-huffaz ala tad'ifih. That all the muhaddithun, all the huffaz of hadith, they have unanimously agreed that this hadith of Tirmidhi Sharif is weak. That this hadith of Tirmidhi Sharif is weak. There's another thing I would like to mention, that those people who say you can do masa on normal socks and they take their hadith from Tirmidhi Sharif, Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, he himself mentions further that this mas'ala, this issue of doing masa on socks, وَهُوَ قَوْلُ غَيْرِ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ, that many scholars have taken the opinion that you can do masa on Jawrabain on socks. وَبِهِ يَقُولُ, and this saying has been taken by Sufyan al-Thawri, Ibn Mubarak, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, Imam Ishaq, rahmatullahi alayhim. They say, يَمْسَهُ عَلَى الْجَوْرَبَيْنِ, that a person can do masa on socks. But the condition Imam Tirmizi further mentioned, إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِينَيْنِ, that when the socks are very thick, when they are thick socks. So Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullah alayhi himself has commented on this hadith that though Jawrabain, doing masa on normal socks, is permissible according to these a'imma, but idha kana thaqikhain, with the condition that they are both thick. Now, what does it mean by that the socks have to be thick? This in front of me, I have Kitab al-Fiqh ala al-Madhahib al-Arba'ah. It's the Kitab of Fiqh on the four schools of thought. Inside here, the author has mentioned the conditions regarding the socks which have to have a certain conditions in order for it to be permissible to do masa'an. He's mentioned that one of the conditions that al-thaqeenayn, an yakuna thaqeenan, that they have to be thick. أي يمنع من وصول الماء إلى ما تحته, that it stops water from entering inside the socks. The second condition is that they stick to the feet without tying it, and a person can walk a certain amount of distance. Now these conditions, some scholars like Imam Shafi and Abdullah Ali have put other conditions in regards to walking. Some say 3 days, 3 nights. Some say a certain amount of miles. But they all agree that it has to be thick and it has to have a certain amount of conditions which will inshallah ta'ala make these jawrabain sakhikhain in the hukum and in the ruling of leather socks. Leather socks. Now this is not qiyas. These three conditions that have been put by these scholars likes of Imam Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh, they are not, it's not just qiyas, but rather they have looked at the overwhelming ahadith regarding leather socks, which are mutawatir. Mutawatir means that a large group of people in the time of the Sahaba, in the time of the Prophet, in the time of the Tabi'in, they have narrated this hadith, a large group of people. And there is no doubt in this hadith. So the hadith regarding doing masa on leather socks is mutawatir. So the ulama, the scholars, the jurists, the fuqaha, they looked into these ahadith regarding leather socks, and from there they extract and they derive these conditions. Therefore, in front of me, Al-Musannaf of Imam Ibn Abi Shayba rahimahullah, the first volume, page 216, in here there is a narration from Sayyid al-Tabi'een Sa'id bin Musayyib rahimahullah and Allamatu al-Tabi'een Hassan ibn Basri rahimahullah. These are two very eminent Tabi'een and very great scholars. They give this fatwa at the time where a large group of Sahaba were present and many great and eminent Tabi'een were also present. They said, قَالَ يَمْسَهُ عَلَى الْجَوْرَبَيْنِ, that a person can do masa on socks, إِذَا كَانَ الصَّفِيقَيْنِ, that when they are thick. So the condition of thickness, it was not just made through a person's logic according to his whims and desires, but these fuqaha and these great scholars, in the presence of Sahaba and the Tabi'een, they analyzed and they looked at the hadith regarding leather socks. And looking at those ahadith, and after analyzing those ahadith, they extract this condition of thickness inside socks. That's why according to Imam Shafi rahmatullahi alayhi and Imam Ahmad bin Hamad rahmatullahi alayhi, you can do masa on socks if they are thick. This we can understand from Tirmizi Sharif. Imam Tirmizi rahmatullahi alayhi himself says regarding Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad bin Hamad rahmatullahi alayhi that to do masa on normals on socks is permissible إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِيخَيْن, when they are thick. Then in the books of Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi and in the books of Imam Ahmad bin Hamad rahmatullahi alayhi, they have greatly explained the details and the conditions regarding these socks. Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, I have this in front of us, Al-Mudawwat al-Kubra. Al-Mudawwat al-Kubra is a book of Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi. In here on page 78, there is a narration that Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, he said it was permissible to do masa on socks which has leather beneath and it has some leather on top. But later on in his life, ثُمَّ رَجَعَ, he had left this opinion and said that it is not permissible to do masa on any type of socks except for leather socks. So Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi, he was with the opinion that if any socks, normal socks, if they have a leather beneath and leather on top, a layer of leather beneath and on top, then doing masa on this is permissible. But later on in his life, he had done rujoo, i.e. he had left this opinion, and he said, "La yumsahu alayhima," that now you cannot even do masa on these. Therefore, masa on khuffain was only left permissible according to Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi. From this, we can tell that Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi most definitely was not with the opinion that you can do masa on normal socks. Regarding Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, he was also with Imam Malik rahmatullahi alayhi that you can only do masa on leather socks. But later on in his life, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi also didn't ruju. Like in Tirmidhi Sharif, there's a narration of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi that when he was ill and just before he passed away, he had socks, thick socks on, which Imam Shafi and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal say you can do masa over, and which have the three conditions. He had those socks on and he called for some water, and then he did masa on these socks. And he said, فَعَلْتُ الْيَوْمَ شَيْئًا لَمْ أَكُنْ أَفْعَلُهُ, that today I have done something which I haven't done before. I.e. till today I used to say that doing masa on thick socks was not permissible, but today I have done something like this. So the fuqaha and the ulama say that this is a dalil that Imam Abu Hanifa, in the latter part of his life, he also was with the opinion that you can do masa on thick socks with the condition. And the conditions have been greatly explained in the books of Ahnaf. In front of me, Al-Bahr al-Ra'iq of Ibn Nujaym, Al-Bahr al-Ra'iq of Ibn Nujaym rahmatullahi alayh, he also mentions this, that Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh, in the end part of his life, he had a rujoo from this. And wa alayhi al-fatwa, and upon this is fatwa. Somebody sahibi hidayah in hidayah, he has also mentioned this. So the net result is, my dear brothers and sisters and honorable listeners, that doing masa on normal socks, the hadith that they give from Tirmidhi Sharif, this hadith is weak. اتفق الحفاظ على تضعيفه, that all the muhaddithun have agreed that this hadith is weak, like Imam Nawawi rahmatullah alayhi has mentioned. This hadith goes against Bukhari Sharif, Muslim Sharif, Abu Dawud Sharif. Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullah alayhi has given several quotations of muhaddithun criticizing this hadith, the likes of Yahya bin Ma'in, the likes of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, the likes of Sufyan al-Thawri and others. And also, Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi himself says that this hadith has been acted upon by many scholars, but they all say with the condition إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِينَيْن, that they have to be thick, and inside the thickness there are conditions greatly and with great detail that have been explained. And from the four scholars, fuqaha, Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi, he says no, that even on thick socks you cannot do masa. And later on in his life, he restricted masa al-jawrabain only on leather socks. And Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayh, he joined Imam Shafi'i and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal and his two students, Imam Abu Yusuf and Imam Muhammad rahmatullahi alayh. And the madhab of Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal and the madhab of Imam Shafi'i can be found in their books and Tirmidhi Sharif itself, where Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayh has mentioned them and then restricted إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِيقِينَ, that the both socks have to be thick. That is the main narration of those brothers who say you can do masa on normal socks. The second narration is Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala an. Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala an hadith can be found in Abu Dawud Sharif hadith. Abu Dawud Sharif, this hadith can be found from Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala an. On page 80, I have this Sunan Abi Dawud in front of me. Page 80. An Abi Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala anhu an Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam annahu masa al jawrabain, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did masa on jawrabain, on socks. Now Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned that this hadith laysa bil muttasil wala bi qawiyin wala bil qawi, that this hadith is not muttasil and neither is this hadith qawi, i.e. this hadith, there is missing links inside the chain of narrators. And also this hadith is not strong. So Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullah alayhi, after mentioning the hadith, he has criticized the hadith, that this hadith is not weak, is not strong and is weak. Similarly, Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullah alayhi has also mentioned narrations of eminent scholars who have criticized this hadith also. There's one thing I forgot to mention regarding the first hadith, which Imam Nasa'i rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned in his As-Sunan al-Kubra, that after a lot of research, He says, ما نعلم أن أحدا تابع أبا قيس على هذه الرواية والصحيح عن المغيرة أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مسح على الخفين. The Imam Nasi mentioned that I don't know anyone who has agreed and who has gone according to Abu Qais on this narration of Mughira bin Shu'bah radiyallahu ta'ala. I.e. the narration of Tirmidhi rahmatullahi in Tirmidhi Sharif where Mughira bin Shu'bah radiyallahu ta'ala mentioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had done masa on Jawrabain. Imam Nasa'i rahmatullahi mentioned that I don't know anyone else who has mentioned the word Jawrabain in authentic narration. So this again is evidence of the weakness of that narration. So we have gone through two narrations. One is Mughira bin Shu'bah radiyallahu ta'ala an in Tirmidhi Sharif, which I have proven from many books and narrations of scholars, and also the narration of Abu Musa Ash'ari in Sunan Abu Dawood, which has been criticized and weakened by Imam Abu Dawood himself, and in As-Sunan al-Kubra of Bayhaqi Sharif, Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullahi alayh has mentioned many quotations and aqwal of muhaddithun, for example, the likes of Yahya bin Ma'in, rahimahullah, and others who have said that this hadith is weak, and the narrator inside this, Isa bin Sanan, who is da'if. Also, he has mentioned that لا يحتج به, that this narration you cannot take as evidence. The third narration, which I would like to mention, is by Thoban radiallahu ta'ala an. And going to the point quickly, I just will mention what Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani rahmatullahi alayhi has to mention about this narration. This narration can be found in Abu Dawood again and Musnad Ahmad, that Thawban radiallahu ta'ala says, Ba'atha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sariyatan. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had sent an army, a group of people, فَأَصَابَهُمُ الْبَرْضِ, and cold had reached these people, they start to feel cold. فَأَمَرَهُمْ أَن يَمْسَحُوا عَلَى الْعَصَائِبِ وَالتَّسَاخِينَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered them to do masa on asaib and tasakhin. Asaib means, in this narration, عَمَائِم, i.e. their turbans. And tasakhin means socks. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he ordered the Sahaba at this time to do masa over their turbans and to do masa over their socks. So the word tasakhin has come here. Now the word tasakhin can mean any socks. And there's a possibility that from this we can derive that doing masa on normal socks is permissible due to the word tasakhin. But Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani rahimahullah says, وَإِسْنَادُهُ مُنْقَطِعُ, that the isnad and the chain of this hadith is munqati, i.e. there is a missing link. And secondly, he mentioned وَضَعْفَهُ الْبَيْحَقِ, Imam Bayhaqi rahmatullahi alayhi has also weakened this hadith. وَقَالَ الْبُخَارِ حَدِيثٌ لَا يَصِّحُ, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi mentioned about this hadith, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi, that this hadith is not authentic. And walafdu Ahmad, and the words of Imam Ahmad, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم توضى ومسى على خفيه. So the authentic words in this narration are خفيه and تساخين. So this is the third narration of Thawban radiallahu ta'ala an, where the word socks have come, and there's a possibility that we can take normal socks from here. But this hadith, Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani mentions that this hadith is munqati'. Imam Bayhaqi also criticizes hadith. Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi alayhi said this hadith is not authentic, and the authentic words are khuffayn and not tasakhin. This explanation can be found in Ad-Diraya of Ibn Hajar Asqalani fi takhrij ahadith al-hidayah, under the chapter of Bab al-Masih al-Khuffayn, where Hafiz Ibn Hajar Asqalani has criticized this hadith, quoting many eminent scholars. The last hadith, which I would like to mention, the final hadith, is hadith of Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala an. And this hadith can be found in Tabarani. This I have in front of me, Tuhfat al-Ahwadi, the commentary of Tirmidhi Sharif. In here is mentioned that the hadith of Bilal radiyallahu ta'ala is also weak. Why? Because there are there are two sanads, there are two narrations, and both are weak. First is weak because Imam A'mash rahmatullahi alayh, who was criticized by Imam Zahabi in Mizan, that he is weak. And the second sanad, in there is Yazid bin Abi Ziyad, who is also Za'if. And Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani in his book, in Taqrib, he has mentioned that he was very weak, very old, وَكَانَ شِيْعِيًّا, and he was a Shia. Intiha, that's where he finished. So two narrations from Bilal radiallahu ta'ala regarding doing masa on socks. It has been criticized by Alama Zahabi and Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani. That's why, in this book, Tuhfatul Ahwadi, the author has come to a conclusion regarding doing masa on normal socks. He says, والحاصل أنه ليس في باب المسح على الجوربين حديث مرفوع صحيح خال عن الكلام. That the net result is, the khulaisa kalam is, that regarding doing masa on normal socks, there is no hadith which is marfu, which is authentic and which is free from any criticism. There is no hadith regarding doing masa on normal socks, which is marfu, i.e. the link, the chain goes all the way to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and which is authentic and free from any criticism. Now, a question may arise that these conditions
which the Aimma have put regarding thick socks, where have they got these conditions from? When the word Jawrabain have been mentioned mutlaq, generally inside the hadith, then doing masa on normal socks should be permissible, and doing masa on thick socks should also be permissible. So mashallah, the author tackles this very well. He says, قَدْ وَقَعَ فِي أَحَادِثِ, the objection is, قَدْ وَقَعَ فِي أَحَادِثِ الْبَابِ لَفْظُ الْجَوْرَبَيْنِ مُطْلَقًا أَغَيْرَ مُقَيِّدٍ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْقُيُودِ الَّتِي قَيَّدَهُمَا بِهَا هَؤُلَاءِ الْأَئِمَّةِ فما بالهم قيدوهما بها واشترطوا جواز المسح عليهما بتلك القيود فبعضهم بالتجليد وبعضهم بالتنعيل وبعضهم بالصفاقة والثقولة. That when the words جوربين have come inside the hadith socks, مطلقا general, there is no restriction of any conditions. So what is the difference? Why is it that some people have put conditions? If that is permissible, then those socks which don't have any conditions should also be permissible. Where have the a'imma, where have the scholars got these conditions from, these qiyud? So the author answers that al-asl huwa ghasl rijlain kama huwa zahir al-Quran. That the actual hukum, the actual commandment in wudu is to wash the feet. The actual hukum and the actual commandment regards to wudu is washing the feet. والعدول عنه لا يجوز, and to leave this hukum and to turn away from this commandment is not permissible. إلا بأحاديث صحيحة اتفق على صحتها أئمة الحديث, except through authentic ahadith upon which all of the muhaddithun have agreed that is authentic, like the ahadith regarding doing masa on leather socks. Then he mentions that therefore we cannot leave these ahadith and do masa on normal socks, especially those narrations which are weak, very feeble, and criticized by many muhaddithun. But when the socks are thick, then these socks, they come into the hukam. They come into the hukam of khuffain, of leather socks. And like I mentioned, brothers, these sharait and conditions of doing masa on thick socks, this fatwa was given in the time of the Sahaba by Sa'id bin Musayyib and Hasan Basri rahimahumullah, where there was a large group of Sahaba and Tabi'in present. Also, this is the mazhab of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayh, Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayh, and Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal rahmatullahi alayh. So the khulasa is, the net result is, that doing masa on normal socks, which we have today. And water does enter the socks, and a person cannot walk a certain amount of distance inside socks. These socks, they're not permissible to do masa on according to any of the Imams. Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal, Imam Shafi'i, Imam Malik, Imam Abu Hanifa. And those ahadith which might give the impression that yes, you can do masa on those socks, they have been criticized by big muhaddithun, big scholars, eminent scholars of Islam. And Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi has also mentioned in his book that the hadith, the jawrabain, the condition idha kana thaqilain. One last thing I would like to mention before I finish is that some people, they use Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi as evidence. This again is Tuhfatul Ahwadi, Sharah of Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi's book. In here, he has quoted Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi. Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi in his fatawa, and these brothers who are with the opinion that you can do masa on normal socks usually take the opinions and aqwal of Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi. In his fatawa, Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned يجوز المسعى للجوربين إذا كان يمشي فيهما. That doing masa on normals on socks is permissible when a person can walk inside these. Whether they have سواء كان المجلد أو لم تكن, whether these socks they have any leather piece on or not. And then further, Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah mentions his reasons. So the answer to this has been given by the author that كلام الحافظ ابن تيمية هذا ليس مخالفا لما اخترنا من أن الجوربين إذا كان ثقيلين صفيقين يمكن تتابع مشي فيهما يجوز المسح عليهما فإنهما في معنى الخفين. فإنه رحمه الله تعالى قيد جواز المسح على الجوربين بقوله إذا كان يمشي فيهما وظاهر أن تتابع المشي فيهما لا يمكن فيهما إلا إذا كان ثقيلين. That what Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah رحمة الله عليه mentioned is not against what we have chosen. That doing masa on normal socks with the condition that they are thick and is possible to walk constantly and to do masa, is permissible to do masa on, this is not against what Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah has mentioned. Why? Because Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi has mentioned, he has restricted his kalam, he has restricted his text with the word إِذَا كَانْ يَمْشِي فِيهِمَا, that when it's possible to walk inside the socks. So Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah has mentioned that to do masa on socks is permissible, but he's restricted it إِذَا كَانَ يَمْشِي فِيهِمَا, that when it's possible for a person to walk inside the socks. Now the author mentioned that it is apparent and it's obvious that a person can only constantly walk inside normal socks إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِينَيْن, when those socks are thick. The normal socks that we have today, it is not possible to constantly and تَتَابُوا الْمَشْ, to constantly walk inside these socks is not possible. So Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullahi alayhi, what he has mentioned in his fatawa, in reality if we contemplate, it does not go against the madhab of Imam Ahmed bin Hanbal and Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi. Because those scholars, they have conditioned it that they are thick. And Imam Hafiz ibn Taymiyyah also mentioned, إِذَا كَانْ يَمْشِي فِيهِمَا, that when it's possible to walk. Now if we slightly contemplate, we'll come to the conclusion that to constantly walk in socks can only be done إِذَا كَانَ ثَخِينَيْن, that when they are both thick. Like he has mentioned in Tuhfatul Ahwadi. So the net result is, my dear brothers and elders, that doing masa on normal socks is not permissible to any of the, according to any of the Aimmah. There is no authentic hadith from which we can derive that doing masa on normal socks is permissible. And if a person does masa on normal socks and then he does wudu, this will render his salah invalid and his namaz will be void and fasid. He will have to repeat the same salah again. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq and the true understanding of iman. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all from the ways of shaitan. Wa akhu da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin.